Paul told them, you need to do that. This is an interesting part of the story. The sailors. You see who wants to get away in the lifeboat? It's the sailors. Well, if all the sailors leave, who's going to sail the ship because they know what it's about? That's why Paul says, you know, none of us, we're not going to survive here if that's the case. And so the soldiers go over and cut the ropes to the lifeboat. Because he said, if they leave. Now, he was right before, so I'd listen to him. He has this special measure with God, and we'll look at that too in a minute. But they wanted to escape. These guys wanted to escape, which was the worst thing. Friends, I want to tell you, oftentimes Jesus is not looking for an escape route with us. He's looking for a strength route with us. He's looking for a testimony route with us. He's looking for a kingdom-building opportunity with us, that we are supposed to continue, even when the storm is raging, to obey, to serve him, to walk with him. That's what he calls in the midst of the storm. But that can be hard, because what happens is people look and they have these storms going on and they say, well, Satan says into their minds, if God loves you, why is he letting you experience this? Why are you going through this and the hardship of all of that? So let's look at weathering the storm. What do we do to survive the storm? Paul points out two things that he has for us in verse 23. It says this. It says, last night, an angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, do not be afraid, Paul. One of the ways in which you and I can weather the storm is we need to remember exactly who we are. We're children of the King. God is a providential God. He has this plan, this kingdom plan, and it may not look in our human eyes like it's a really good plan, but Paul recognized, this is who I am. Whether it's sin issues or whether it's life issues or whether it's somebody else's issues that come into our lives, God has a plan in the midst of all of that. And he knows who he, Paul said, I know who I serve. And we can do that and rest in that as well. Key sentence for you, I believe, today. God always uses storms to teach, strengthen, and to lead us closer to himself. He always uses storms to do that. Storms are never for nothing with the Father. There's always something that he wants to do with us, to us, as faithful believers in the midst of the storm. Typically, it's to draw us closer and to give us a testimony of his grace in our lives. Would you say amen to that? How many of you learned great things in the midst of your storm? How many of you can think right now, just the storm, like, wow, there was so much to garner from that. The second thing that I believe we need to see, he says in verse 25, as it's recorded, so keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. What he's saying there is, I believe God's promises, and I'm going to hold on to that. I'm going to grab. In Isaiah writes that though we go through the water, it will not sweep over us. If we go through the flames, they'll not set us ablaze. That's a promise from God, a promise of God that we're not going to be lost. Even in verse 20, they said, even when all hope is lost, you and I remember that God is still God. And some of you, as you've been through such heartache and brokenness, have found all of that to be true. This week, the Lord spoke into my heart this week and my mind, and I believe I'm supposed to share this with you. When we're in the storm, or when the storm has passed, or Jesus, for a long, long time, I've always thought that Jesus needs to be the center of my life. And that's pretty good. In fact, we sing a wonderful praise song, Jesus Be the Center of My Life. And that's really good. But this week, the Lord spoke into me, into my life, and I want to share it with you. Like, having Jesus at the center of my life is really good. But I think there's something better. Having our lives being at the center of Jesus trumps having Jesus at the center of my life. Think about that for just a minute. I'm not sure I've completely worked through this, but all I know, here's my life, and I put Jesus at the center. Wait a minute. Here's Jesus And I'm at the center of his will and his way. I don't know. It's all encompassed. Visually in my head, I'm trying to think how I can. Some of you are nodding. How many of you know what I'm talking about, even though I can't explain what I'm talking about? You know what I mean? Thank you. You know, I thought about it. It's really cool that I've put Lisa at the center of my life. That's really cool. But wait a minute. It's way cooler that I'm at the center of her life. There's something way cooler about that. So, I don't want to go over it again, but just here are the words. Putting Jesus at the center of our life is good. We being at the center of Jesus is better.